number 8.
And this next story is on a similar theme. Endurance, mental toughness and physical durability. They're the essential requirements of an elite triathlete. But last weekend, a new element entered the equation. Their environmental tolerance was put to the test when 15 of the world's elite were taken into the middle of Australia to complete the world's first time trial. Reporter Ian Buchanan joined them in Alice Springs for the inaugural Toyota International Triathlon.
The Red Centre, surrounded by the majestic McDonnell Ranges, a perfect yet unlikely venue for an international triathlon. Perfect because of the fierce challenges nature presents, unlikely because it's rare that you'd find the world's elite in a remote place like Alice Springs. Four times World Cup champion Brad Bevan headed the 15 athletes hand-picked from France, New Zealand and Australia. All gladly accepted the invitation, ready to pit themselves against the extremes of the rugged Australian outback. In a normal triathlon, the athletes use each other as pace guides. But out here, that and other luxuries have been taken away. A time trial is a true test of individual fitness. The only measure is against the clock.
It's basically going to be held in three separate stages. The swim will be held on day one, and the following morning we'll have the 40k cycle, followed by the 10k run in the afternoon. There's no drafting, of course, in the event. The traditional races around the world now have drafting, which means you sit in another competitor's slipstream.
We were hoping, or some guys were hoping, that we could use heart rate monitors or, you know, even a stopwatch or something, but we're not allowed to wear anything on this sort of course. It is totally an individual time trial.
One and a half hour bus ride delivers them to the first test of their environmental flexibility, a swim at Glen Helen Gorge. At 300 million years old, the Finke River is arguably the oldest river in the world.
The labels are saying 8 degrees.
You're kidding. Yeah, they took the temperature, but I think that was like on the very surface of the water. So maybe if we turn it up a little bit, the boys who swim last may find it a bit colder.
That's after they crack the ice.
Yeah.
Second group, please ensure you're ready. Second group.
I think I'll go on
and walk. Former French national 1500 metres champion Ben Sanson is favourite for the swim. His brother Jerome also tipped to be amongst the leaders. In keeping with the rules of a time trial, swimmers are set off individually in three heats, all aiming for the quickest time to get the edge for the bike and the run legs.
I need to try and get a bigger eye.
The local crowd were in low numbers, but high in enthusiasm. But none could rival the devotion of the spirited French delegation. Ben Sanson's father willing him to go faster. It worked. Ben finished quickest, the only competitor to break the 20-minute barrier over the 1,500 metres. 14 seconds in his wake, Tasmanian Craig Walton and New Zealand champion Hamish Carter.
If no one makes up any time, this is a waste of time.
Just one more thing. On the teardrop turnaround here, there'll actually be the anchors. Once you're all off the start, they'll be moved inside there, OK?
Simpson's Gap, just outside of Alice Springs, is the venue for the cycle. Brad Bevan, disappointed with his fifth place in the swim, would need to make up 55 seconds, while Sanson would have to increase his lead to prepare for his weakest leg, the run.
I had a good day yesterday on the swim, and I've been working hard on the bike, so I hope I will have a good ride and be stay in the leading group at the end of the bike.
Competitors started at 1 minute 30 intervals to help avoid drafting. Walton recorded the slowest time over the first 5Ks, but soon signalled his intentions by pegging Sanson back. Disaster back at the start for Brad Bevan. He met with the same fate as Atlanta cyclist Shane Kelly when his foot came out of the pedal. He continued on, but the fall effectively ended his race hopes.
I suppose it does take a bit out of you mentally, as well as a little bit physically, but mainly mentally you lose that, you're all psyched up, ready to go, and you lose that for a while, but I just never really got any rhythm going for some reason. It just didn't happen all day.
The cycle leg also claimed former Canadian Championship winner Frank Clark, who broke a rear wheel hub. Craig Walton blitzed the field. His nearest rival, 1996 USA Pro Champion Greg Bennett.
And that was my aim, to basically take it out in the ride. You know, that's where I'm going to win the race if I'm going to win it at all. So my goal was to just go for it on the bike.
All were beginning to think the result was a fait accompli.
Well, I mean, it was a tough ride because it felt like a constant headwind and the road was dead. And so, you know, we had it in the big gears just trying to maintain a rhythm. And Craig just, I thought I was keeping all right pace with him, but then I got across the line and it's a minute and a half quicker than me.
The race was now a pursuit. The leader's objective, simple but tough, to hold off the challenges in the 10K run, which included climbing the horrendous Anzac Hill four times, a feat which was now being likened to scaling Mount Everest. The Alice Springs town folk just as excited as the athletes.
We've had some top athletes come through here from time to time, but not together like this, in such an event like this, certainly not in my time.
Oh, I think it was very good, it was very well presented, what I thought of it.
Craig Walton resumed his comfortable lead. In his wake, Greg Bennett and Chris McCormack, the only real threats. The lead of 5 minutes was too much to pull back. The victory tape was reserved for Australia's newest emerging triathlon sensation. It was Craig's biggest career triumph since winning the US Pro Championships last year. The Gold Coast Chris McCormack ran the fastest last leg, crossed third behind Greg Bennett.
It's been fun. It's been really good. Something different. We've seen a totally different lifestyle that people live, I think. And from the racing point of view, it's just been, I think, just something totally different for all the guys. It's been a great concept, and it's just been good for the sport of triathlon.
Ian Buchanan with that report. Race favourite Brad Bevan had a couple of bad days. He finished 10th, but a good result for the fellow Australians Craig Walton, Greg Bennett and Chris McCormack, who held the rest of the internationals out of a podium finish. Frenchman Ben Sanson, who led after the swim, he faded to 5th spot. And the focus for most of these athletes now is the World Championships in Perth in November at the end of the year. Well, the coach of the moment in the AFL...
Sports, the best in local and international sport with the most respected commentators in the business.
Yeah, dear old Ockie, speaking of derby winners, we saw a great one yesterday in Yippee-I-O. Wayne Wilson calling the event for 4TAB. Wayne, it was one of the great derbies. A two-horse race that turned out just that way. Not like Bailey and Johnson, this one, was it?
Not at all. It was a two-horse race. The full length of the straight, they struggled. They went stride for stride. Yippee-I-O got his head in front. Marble Horse tried to lift several times on the inside. He wouldn't shirk the task, Marble Horse, but Yippee-I-O just a little too strong for him at the end. You couldn't have scripted it any better than the way it turned out yesterday, with Jimmy taking off about 800 metres out, Marble Horse coming out in front of him, and then both boys sitting until they got to the straight, and then that battle down that long straight at Eagle Farm, with the honours going to Yippee-I-O at the end. He's a great three-year-old. The other horse is a great three-year-old too, Marble Horse, and it sets it up for the spring now.
And probably sets it up even better, the fact that Yippee-I-O won, I think, Wayne, because Lee Friedman's horse is inexperienced. I know he's had about the same number of starts as Yippee-I-O, but I feel he's a more inexperienced horse. And had he beaten Yippee-I-O yesterday, I think most people would have felt he'd had the wood on him in the spring. Now it's still touch and go.
Yeah, I agree with that. Marble only really came to light here in Brisbane during the carnival, didn't he? He's had three starts here. He won two of them in the second yesterday, whereas Yippee came here with a bigger reputation. So you're right. It sets it up for some great clashes.
The best derby you've called? Best race you've seen?
Yes, I'd say so. It's our best derby in Queensland and the best one that I've called, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, let's have a look at it. And those moves were made with about 800 to go.
How bizarre on the fence, then Pajatinsky, Cassidy about to go forward on Yippee-I-Yo, then Blue Gum and Summer Bow on the fence is last. 700 metres to go, Sakti the leader from Forgotten Hero, Cash for Ash third from Biter Man, Marble Halls is now going forward on the outside from Hornet Banner Headline, Yippee-I-Yo is tracking Marble Halls to the home turn from How Bizarre, Summer Bow, and then Pajatinsky and Blue Gum is last. Around the corner, 450 to run on the derby, and the leader Forgotten Hero from Biter Man, Marble Halls coming up, and Yippee-I-Yo on the outside, and then Summer Bow. The pressure's on, 300 metres to go. Marble Halls and Yippee-I-Yo, they've taken the lead together with Yippee-I-Yo dashing past Marble Halls, which won't give up, and then Summer Bow. Yippee-I-Yo ducked in on top of Marble Halls, and they're together with 100 to go. Yippee-I-Yo and Marble Halls. Yippee-I-Yo's the neck in front. Marble Halls can't pick him up, and Yippee-I-Yo wins a great derby. Yippee-I-Yo beat Marble Halls, 6 lengths away, third Summer Bow.
Wayne, I think the thing that was interesting too is that the third horse is No Mug. He's a very good horse in his own right, and they beat him out of sight, Summer Bow.
Well, he's a two-time Wait for Age winner, Bruce, and yet they beat him by 5 lengths. It was a very tough staying performance, wasn't it, by both of these three-year-olds, because they had to make long runs. As Yippee-I-Yo, he's cruising up to Marble Halls at this stage, and you'd think that Yippee-I-Yo was going to draw away from him and beat him clearly. And they're wanting to lay in towards the rails over the final stages of the race, but Marble Halls would not surrender. He just came back fighting with every stride that he took. But Yippee-I-Yo just a little too tough in the run to the line. But full credit to both horses. Outstanding performances, and as you say, Bruce, one of the great derbies.
Let me put you on the spot. I remember about 3 years ago you said, I'll tip you Paris Lane. He went on and won the Caulfield Cup, was second in the Melbourne Cup. If you had to back one of these horses now in the Melbourne Cup, which one would you be putting your money on?
Well, let me tip you Marble Halls to win the Caulfield Cup and Yippee-I-Yo to win the Melbourne Cup.
I've written it down. What about the Stradbroke? You say not too often the $1 million race. I think this is your best race year in, year out, the Stradbroke, but I thought it was a little upstage yesterday by the Derby. It was still a very good race in its own right.
Well, there was so much hype about the Derby, sure, but the Stradbroke turned out to be a beauty, and again, heroes to the fore there, with Bart Cummings winning his fourth Stradbroke, Chris Munce turning in a super performance to win on Dane Ripper, well back approaching the home turn, but storming down the outside over the final stages. Bart, as I mentioned, did a great job with Dane Ripper because she's had joint problems in the past, and retirement was on the drawing boards for her, but it looks as though she'll continue racing now. Bart will persevere with her a little bit longer. No excuses to come out of the Stradbroke yesterday. Future King was held up in the straight. Maybe he should have run second. Blazing Steel was held up in the straight. Maybe he should have finished in a place. But let me tell you, nothing would have beaten Dane Ripper.
Well, not too many fillies win this. I think only a couple in the last 30 or 40 years. Let's see how Bart and Chris Munce got Dane Ripper to the line.
800 to go, quick flick at a good bat led Malaguar, Celestial Choir, Accomplice in the box seat, fourth on the inside, Confiscate fifth, then Lord Luskin, Catlin opening, Eastern Star, Mamzelle Padrill travelling deep from Dane Ripper cohort, Kidman's Cove, Future King, Super Dane. Further back in the field, Faience as they near the home turn, Monopolise deep from Shame, Blazing Steel last about to come to the outside. In the straight, 425 to go, quick flick joined by Malaguar, Confiscate about a length away on the outside, Accomplice in the middle, wider out on the track, Celestial Choir, Catlin opening, and Mamzelle Padrill and Dane Ripper, quick flick in front of the 200 metres mark, Accomplice getting out inside, Malaguar, Celestial Choir, and look at Dane Ripper, the filly down the outside, Dane Ripper's coming with giant strides after quick flick and Dane Ripper's going the better, Dane Ripper wins the Stradbroke, Dane Ripper from a photo between, quick flick, Celestial Choir and Future King.
Yes, the $1 million race going to the three-year-old filly. John Hawkes, great trainer that he is, you wouldn't believe. 6 runners yesterday, and he didn't finish in the first 5. Those, you would have got about 100-1 about that, wouldn't you?
Yeah, quite amazing, isn't it? We thought he had a chance of trifectoring the Stradbroke handicap, but it just didn't turn out that way. Luck went against him.
What about Accomplice, Wayne?
Well, he was given the run of the race by a die on the fence. Maybe he's just come to the end of it, this preparation. He's been up for quite some time. There was every opportunity for him to take full advantage of that gap between the two greys there, Quick Flick and Malaguar, but he couldn't do that. Look at Dane Ripper, she's gobbling them up on the outside, giant strides. Oh, quick flick over on the inside gave his supporters a mighty sight, and Jimmy Cassidy almost brought off the Group 1 double at Eagle Farm yesterday, but Dane Ripper just too good.
Now tomorrow, the last two Group 1 races of the year, the Castlemaine and the Brisbane Cup. You got a tip?
Well, we've got a marvellous day at Eagle Farm. Le Mans, I think, is nearly as special in the Castlemaine. The Cup, however, is very open, 6-1 the field. I'm thinking Desert Chill for Chris Munce. I'm thinking NASA Rich for Bart Cummings. And what about Waterhouse? If she can win the Cup with Alacrity, it'll go down as one of the greatest training performances ever. Just two runs into a two-mile race. But Alacrity's there with a real chance. Tough race, the Cup.
Well, David Fordham's not far away. He wants to get that absolute tip. So you better find out tomorrow morning, Wayne. So we'll listen to your tips. Wayne, the Silver Charm in the Belmont today finished second. He was going for a $5 million bonus. He was beaten into second placing by Touch Gold. He'd won the Kentucky Derby and the Preakness. This is the Triple Crown in America. I think the last horse to do it was Affirmed in 1978. So he's missed out Silver Charm, the grey. Another grey just missed out last night at Epsom. We might just show the closing stages of this great race again. Benny the Dip had won the Mekadante Stakes, which is a good lead-up trial. Silver Patriot coming at him had won the Lingfield Derby trial. Entrepreneur, the hottest of hot favourites, finished fourth. Wayne, the inside actually gets it. It looks like Silver Patriarch had him on the outside.
Oh, gee, I think I would have gone for the outside horse. Aren't those boys extravagant with their whip actions over there?
They sure are. So that was the Derby. Wayne, catch you next week. Thanks for that.
Okay,
good calling tomorrow.
Thank you.
And we've got a big program lined up coming up after Sports World with both the footy panel for the Southern States and Sunday Football. Rex Hunt with the footy panel and David Fordham with Sunday Football. I'll join you next week at 9 o'clock on Sports World.
And judging from Monday at Mystic Rock,